And thanks for joining us for our second telephone town hall on the Bighorn Country proposal. We'll get started in a few minutes. I'm John Muir, Communications Director with Alberta Environment and Parks, and I'll be your host this evening. If you want to ask a question about the Bighorn Country, please press *3 and you'll be transferred to a live agent who will provide you with further instructions. We're going to address as many questions as possible over the next hour, and for those listening through the online live stream, you can type your question into the dialogue box, and we'll do our best to answer those questions as well. I'm joined by the Honorable Shannon Phillips, Alberta's Minister of Environment and Parks, for tonight's live town hall discussion about the Bighorn Country proposal. Thanks for joining us tonight, Minister Phillips.
Well, thanks, John. Tonight, I'm looking forward to hearing your questions about the Bighorn Country proposal. We Albertans understand the importance of preserving our wild areas. And we also all want strong recreation plans that ensure future generations can continue to get outside and enjoy nature. That's who we are as Albertans. If we can all agree on one thing, it's that nature is worth preserving and protecting. Over 1 million people have moved to Alberta in the last decade, and as more and more people discover the Bighorn area, we're seeing pressures mounting on the landscape. These pressures are reaching a tipping point, and we're running the risk of losing the very things that make Bighorn special in the first place. Its pristine natural beauty, its delicate ecosystems and habitat, and its recreation opportunities. That's why we have come forward with a proposal that includes a mix of land use designations, such as new provincial parks, new recreation areas, and possibly a new public land use zone. For Albertans, success means supporting recreation opportunities in this beautiful region, preserving our natural environment, and maintaining existing industrial uses, including oil and gas, forestry, and grazing growing into the future. This plan comes with a $40 million investment in operations for boosting enforcement on the landscape, including reopening the Nordegg Ranger Station, as well as new infrastructure such as campgrounds, trails, bridges, and staging areas for both motorized and non-motorized recreation. I want to clear the air on something important. Recently, in consultation with government security officials and seeing some concerning reports from Albertans, we chose to postpone the public information sessions. We did this while also booking these telephone town halls to continue providing information and answering questions from all Albertans. We did not take this decision lightly. It was based on the behavior of a small minority of people, and it is clear that the vast majority of Albertans have participated in this project respectfully. We know how much in-person sessions mean to you. We understand that, and that's why we're currently working on rescheduling those sessions as soon as possible. Albertans have the right to have their voice heard and consulted. But Albertans also have the right to feel safe and secure at public engagements. We have both obligations as government. I also want to take a moment and address some of the misinformation that I've seen floating around on social media. First, this proposal means no changes whatsoever to designated OHV trails in the area. We know this is an important recreation activity in the Bighorn, and there have been many responsible local groups that have undertaken stewardship of these trails over the years. And in fact, some of our $40 million investment is to improve existing trails and support the local user groups that have been doing this work. We want to work with local groups to improve access and enjoyment of the trails and ensure they are sustainable for future Albertans. This proposal also looks at a trail pass system that would ensure long-term funding to those voluntary organizations. And I am looking forward to hearing more about whether Albertans support that trail pass system. Second, it's really important to be clear here. There is no effect on current or future forestry or oil and gas developments, jobs, or investment in the West Country Public Land Use Zone. Public land use zones govern recreation only. And in fact, they're in place so that we can balance recreation and industrial development, so that recreation doesn't get in the way of oil and gas job safety or forestry jobs. We have been careful to consider impacts to forestry and oil and gas and other industry when developing these proposed new areas. Existing grazing leases as well will not be affected. What this proposal does bring is government to the table as a partner to support the experiences that we all enjoy in Bighorn. That means that we can better allocate resources to the area to improve recreation and user experiences and create long-term predictability for industry. That includes having enforcement officers on the landscape to manage conflict and to ensure that we are protecting the environment. And so third, I want to make something very clear. Bighorn will not become an expensive tourism attraction. Our proposal does not include government-funded hotels and lodges. That is false. There are many local tourism operators in the region that provide experiences to both Albertans and visitors, and they're creating jobs while they do so. Our investment in operations, in park rangers, in planning, and conservation officers will support those local businesses and the many Albertans who are already making a living on the Bighorn landscape. Thank you. I look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you, Minister. For those of you just joining us, we're here with the Honourable Shannon Phillips, Alberta's Minister of Environment and Parks, and we're here to hear your thoughts on the Bighorn Country proposal. I also want to mention that we're joined by other Environment and Parks staff here in the room. They include Rick Blackwood, Assistant Deputy Minister of Strategy, Jamie Bruja, Director of Land and Environmental Planning, Philip Hoffer, Regional Director of Parks, Central Region. So let's get started. Again, to ask Minister Phillips a question about the proposed plan for Bighorn Country, just press star 3 on your phone and let us know that you'd like to speak live on the call. You'll then speak to an operator who will provide you with further instructions. So without further delay, let's take our first question from online. Minister, the question is, why is all this necessary?
Sure. Well, I think I thank you for the question. And there's certainly been a lot of chatter about Bighorn, and it's a good question. Why are we doing this? Well, a million people have moved to Alberta in the last decade or so. And many of those people, the vast majority, want to get outside, want to make those memories with their family and friends in the beautiful nature that Alberta provides. And we can't continue to do that in a way that doesn't ensure that people have the right kinds of supports to get outside. So whether that means good staging areas for trails, motorized or non-motorized, whether that means ensuring we have proper garbage disposal or fire pits or toilets even for people. That is something that protects the environment, but also makes sure that we can provide those high-quality experiences that people will want to come back for, whether they're Albertans or whether they're from outside of the province. Certainly, now is the time to ensure that we have a park system that can keep pace with what Albertans expect. We have some of the most beautiful landscapes in the world here. We all know this. It's one of the reasons why we all live here. But we need to make sure that those are appropriately supported. You know, when I first took over this position as Parks Minister, we had a massive infrastructure deficit. It was something like two-thirds of our parks infrastructure that was rated in fair to poor condition. We have invested some in our park system, but there's more to be done. And we have wonderful opportunities to make sure that we can deliver those high-quality experiences for us all to enjoy.
Thanks, Minister. For those of you just joining us on the line, I'm John Muir, your host for this evening, and I'm here with the Honourable Shannon Phillips, Alberta's Minister of Environment and Parks, and tonight we're talking about the province's proposed plan for Bighorn Country. Again, if you'd like to ask a question of the Minister, please press star 3 on your phone and let us know you'd like to speak live on the call. Our next question is online as well, and the question is, can I still hunt and fish in parks?
The answer is yes. I don't know if there's any more to add, really, other than wildland parks. Obviously, hunting and fishing is no change, the same with public land use zones. Certainly in the provincial parks, the only real restriction is around the provincial recreation areas. So obviously, if there are some new provincial recreation areas where there are things like picnic tables that we won't want people discharging firearms around those areas. But the short answer is yes, with increasing some of our enforcement, but also some planning and making sure we've got investment in things like bridges so we get wheels out of water, we'll be able to recover some of our fish populations in particular as well. I don't know if there's more to add on this, really. I mean, it's pretty cut and dried question, so I think we can move on.
Thanks, Minister. For those of you just joining us, we are talking about government's proposed plan for the Bighorn Country. And if you have a question of the minister, please press star 3. Our next question is from the phone, and it's from Perry in Drayton Valley. Perry, go ahead. Your line is open.
Hello. I'd like to know how the public land use for the future industrial would change in the parks, and also that we've seen that there's already trails for the ATVs and stuff shut down here by Drayton Valley, and more, furthermore, I'd like to know, like, why is this park even being put in? I don't remember voting anybody consulting us and voting on this to get it put in. Like, it seems like it's just being rammed down our throats, and we like it the way it is.
Sure. Well, thank you for that question. And a lot of people have asked about the public land use zone and future, and it has absolutely no effect on any future land sales or other oil and gas leases or forestry activity or any other activity, whether it's grazing leases or sand and gravel or any other mineral or other exploration that might happen. The only thing that a public land use zone does is it ensures a balance between the recreation and the industry, so that, for example, we don't have rutting and compaction along pipeline right-of-ways or regenerated cut blocks as a result of recreational use that increases our costs and our liability on tenure holders. Also, what it does is ensures that we are not getting in the way of forestry companies or oil and gas companies with a runaway recreational development, but that the recreation piece is ensuring that people are still making a living off of the landscape. But there's also some mutually beneficial opportunities, right? Conversion of forestry access roads to off-highway vehicle or mountain biking trails is certainly a possibility. We've seen it in other areas. Or conversion of end-of-life well sites to rustic camping nodes is another opportunity in a public land use zone. As for the length of time that the public land use zone has been under consideration, the Regional Advisory Council advice that came in 2014 recommended planning tools in the West Country area. And even before that, some of the other economic development opportunities have been identified dating back to 1992 from Clearwater County and others. This is a long-standing conversation in central Alberta, but certainly this is a consultation. So the fact is that the boundaries certainly of the West Country public land use zone are something that we are asking Albertans for their feedback on. And a public land use zone is not a park. It is a much, much different a piece of legislation. And it does not have an impact on existing or future industrial activities of any kind. I don't know if there's a little bit more context in terms of the previous government's consultations on this matter or going back a few years. Maybe you might want to add.
Yeah, thanks for that. Just off of the RAC advice, There was extensive discussion about it, and as was mentioned, there was a need and presented that some kind of policy tool was necessary, and under the Public Lands Act, that's really our tool as a public land use zone. We've had a lot of discussions with recreational groups in the area, from the Clearwater Trails Initiative right through to the Bighorn Standing Committee, and on tools and ways to help manage recreation, and really the tool available is a public land use zone. And Minister Phillips has really adequately stressed many times it's to manage recreation, not to manage industry in any way. And it's to help better integrate those activities on the landscape, not necessarily restrict them.
Okay, if you're just joining us, we're taking questions tonight on the government's plan for the proposal for the Bighorn Country. Our next caller is from Heidi in Drayton Valley. Heidi, your line is open.
But thank you very much. I'd just like to ask the minister, hi Shannon, how are you? I'd just like to ask why the short length of time for consultation? your online survey is 70 days long, and gosh, we know, you know, pipelines have been taking longer than that to consult about. And your opening statement, you mentioned that you're considering bringing back the in-person consultations as soon as you possibly can. So it just feels to me that why the hurry? Like, why not wait and continue open consultations until everyone is clear of exactly what is going on?
Well, thank you for that question, and just want to make sure that everybody knows that we've extended the consultation period until February 15th, so it's longer than the original announcement, certainly, and what we're also ensuring is that we've had a conversation about these boundaries, in particular for the West Country Public Land Use Zone, that people in Drayton and potentially Brazeau as well seem concerned about. We're certainly open to looking at those boundaries. There's no question that the Regional Advisory Council in 2014 recommended certain boundaries, and that is fine. We're now hearing back from the public on that. Certainly, as I enumerated, we've had years and years of talk about this. From various counties, various municipal leaders, various business owners, and so on in the area who see the real opportunity associated with Bighorn. This is the first step. Certainly in a longer consultation exercise with respect to public land use zones in particular and how they will involve the local community in a multi-year exercise of planning and ensuring that we have resources to back up that planning. I don't know if there's any other points to be made here from some of our officials we have in the room.
Thanks, Minister. I think one of the things as well is there was significant advice provided in the winter and spring of 2018 in regards to RAC advice. That was put out for public consultation as well, and that was used again as another building block to help inform this process.
We're talking tonight the plans for Bighorn Country. We're joined by the Honourable Shannon Phillips, Minister of Environment and Parks. Our next question comes from Sherry in Millett. Sherry, your line is open. Go ahead.
Hi.
Hi, Sherry.
I went to the town hall and I was encouraged by what the Alberta Parks people had to say. My main question to them was, what can I be told to let me know that things like the areas that will become new provincial parks, how do I know that that's going to be accessible to rural Albertans, specifically farmers who can't pre-book, who just want to go out when haying's done, gather the family together? That's kind of the appeal of random camping, and I think some of the fear is that that's being taken away and limiting the access for Albertans that cannot plan and book and pay for a site, so the kind of lower income rural Albertans. I'm specifically thinking of Eagle Creek as an example, where we could go before at a moment's notice, and now it possibly will be a provincial park and a paid campsite, which kind of limits access to a lot of us rural, possibly equestrian users. So I'm not sure if anyone can speak to that.
I can absolutely speak to that, Sherry. Thank you for that question. And something that we see with random camping, and you probably know this too, is that it's not so random. It generally takes place. People have their favorite spots, and generally speaking, our conservation officers and other folks know where those places are. So what we've done in other places where this is an issue is we've essentially just zoned them as what we call rustic camping nodes. It doesn't mean to say that you have to go to a certain space. It means that along a certain area, it's sort of zoned that way, and then people can have access to, they can go down to one place where you'll see that there are fire rings available for people to use. Or there are specific garbage drop-off points for people to use who have availed themselves of that backcountry experience, but we've got a little bit of support in place. Now, there are areas, and we all know this because we've all been out there, where if there's an area where the bank is starting to fall away, where there's either unsafe from a people point of view or from a fish habitat point of view or that kind of thing, where over time, and whether this is the case, whether it's a public land use zone or with a park or even vacant public land in some cases, where officials will just say, no, this is not safe here, but how about over there? And that's exactly the same thing that would continue, right? We're not seeing any changes to that sort of rustic camping experience other than use a fire ring if they're there for you. Put your garbage in the place where people are asking you to. In some cases, we will be able to provide pit toilets or that kind of thing. In general, what this is about is providing a higher quality experience for families like yours who just want to get out there on the weekend, but also having a few different tools for folks that, and we've all seen them, are not quite as responsible, right? Leaving garbage and that kind of thing. And that's not a situation that anyone wants. We all know that we have that challenge on our public land in Alberta. And I think taking action on it makes us proud as Albertans. Seeing it makes us less proud as Albertans. And so we know that there are some simple things we can do to support people in that. Now, on the campground booking piece of the question, of course, things start in early February, right? So if you do know that there's a particular weekend and a particular place you want to go, whether it's north, central, or south, keep an eye on albertaparks.ca for all of those updates when you can actually book. I know that it's sometimes a challenge to get those sites, and that's why we need to invest in our parks and campgrounds, right? As for the fees, we have not raised them. We're trying to keep them as affordable as possible for people who do want that front country experience.
Thanks for your question, Sherry, and thanks everyone for joining us tonight. Reminder that if you do have a question for the minister, to press *3 on your phone and to be put through to an agent who will guide your question forward. Our next question is from the online, and the question is for Minister: what does $40 million do? Is it all towards hotels and lodges?
Precisely none of it is for hotels and lodges, in fact. The $40 million basically shakes down into two buckets, in capital and in operations. In operations, you're looking at investments in park rangers, in park interpreters, and conservation officers. So that enforcement presence and that education and interpretation presence on the landscape. As for capital, Roughly, you're looking at things like new staging areas, new provincial recreation areas, whether it's day use or refurbishment of old ones, because many of us have been out there and seen that not a lot's gone on in terms of investment in the area since, in some cases, the 80s or the 70s. Some refurbishment of existing campgrounds. Again, to Sherry's point, that even if you can book a campsite, sometimes if you have an RV now, the campsites aren't big enough. Right. And so we've been working on having more pull through sites, those kinds of things, you know, 21st century amenities for 21st century camping. We've been working on that elsewhere. And so we're looking at refurbishing some of the existing campgrounds, but then adding loops to those campgrounds as well. So it's not for necessarily creating a whole bunch of new development, but using the existing footprint where we know we've got tons of demand. Another piece of the puzzle is, of course, that supports for the rustic camping that Sherry from Millet was just talking about. So all of those things cost money in terms of fire rings and that sort of stuff. I mean, that stuff's not free either. And the other piece is, of course, some of the supports for motorized recreation in particular, making sure we're keeping wheels out of water, making sure that we're working with the Bighorn Backcountry Steering Committee to be able to make those investments where they know they've been taking care of the landscape and they know where those investments need to be made. This way, we will have a government that is working in partnership with them. So that's roughly the breakdown. It's not $40 million all at once, far from it. It's the plan is over 5 years. And what that will do is bring the infrastructure up to a basic level where it's no longer in poor condition and it reflects some of our 21st century challenges.
We're talking the proposal for Bighorn Country. Tonight, our next call is from Shane in Drayton Valley. Shane, your line is open.
Oh.
Shane, go ahead.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, your line is open. Go ahead with your question of the minister.
Hello, Minister. I do agree that we need to do something, but why can we not see the total plan before the bill is passed? Previous government was actually working on this, as you've stated, and I agree that you're the one that stepped in to do something about it, but I keep looking at Castle. What you said one thing, then local people ended up living with a totally different reality. And my second question is, where will the $40 million come from? We're already indebted so much that where is this going to come from?
Well, thank you for that question. And the first question has to do with the North Saskatchewan Regional Plan. Of course, the previous government went out with a consultation with the Regional Advisory Council on the NSRP. And certainly within the Regional Advisory Council advice, there were a number of different recommendations with respect to, you know, what one might call the West Country or more broadly the Bighorn Country. In many respects, most respects, this plan reflects that advice. As for the rest of the North Saskatchewan Regional Plan, here's the thing. When we put out the RAC advice, the Regional Advisory Council's advice, previous government's advice for public consultation, what ended up coming back to us was mostly related to the Bighorn. Now, this is an area that stretches from the British Columbia border all the way over to the Saskatchewan border. It encompasses our second largest city. It encompasses the industrial heartland, of course, our refineries and other manufacturing that really power our economy. This is not just about the Bighorn. Certainly, the North Saskatchewan region is very, very diverse. A lot of agricultural activity, other types of ecosystems like, you know, Elk Island, Beaver Hills, we've got grasslands, all kinds of different things going on there. So because I heard so much back from the Regional Advisory Council on the Bighorn, we made the decision to go ahead and put this out for consultation first. Certainly this is the first step, right, of consultations, certainly on the boundaries with respect to a public land use zone, but also even in terms of some of the provincial park proposals and so on. In both cases of the park and the public land use zone, it's going to be followed by a multi-year parks recreation process done in partnership with local municipalities, with user groups, with all Albertans. So that's the piece on the NSRP. The piece around Castle is that we have a much different landscape here in central Alberta than we did in southern Alberta. Certainly in southern Alberta, ranchers came to me and said over and over again that the recreational activity was getting in the way of their being able to make a living. That coupled with the fact that it's a much smaller landscape, it's about 20% of the size of what's being contemplated in terms of Bighorn here, and a number of other really important drivers to the decision, not the least of which was an emergency protection order for some of our native trout species, the fact that we had over 3,000 stream crossings and less than 300 bridges, that piece it became a fact that we had to make some hard decisions and do some planning in the Porcupine-Livingston area to meet the needs of the ranchers there too. In a much smaller area with a lot fewer resources in terms of what was actually going on the ground. The Bighorn Backcountry Steering Committee is a much different situation. The Bighorn area is, like I said, it's about five times larger. We see far fewer wheels in water, stream crossing, those kinds of issues. We still have some trout issues, but we don't have an emergency protection order under the Species at Risk Act that we're dealing with there in the same way. Those are the big, big differences. The biggest one I would say, though, in both cases we had the issues around land use planning in those particularly beautiful areas attracted a lot of public attention in the South Saskatchewan regional planning process and in the North Saskatchewan regional planning process. The reason why they have attracted so much attention is because Albertans love to spend time there. And I want to help them do that. But I also want to make sure that that nature is there for our friends and our families and us to enjoy for generations to come. That and we cannot do that by simply turning our backs on it and hoping for the best. Our government must be a partner in preserving the beauty that we all kind of look upon and think, now that is quintessentially Albertan.
Thanks, Shane, for your question. Tonight we have the Honorable Shannon Phillips taking your questions on the Bighorn Country. Just a reminder, if you are on the line, to press star 3 to ask your question of the minister. Our next call comes from Shane in Sylvan Lake. Shane, your line is open.
Hello? Hello?
Go ahead, Shane, your line is open.
Hello?
Yes, Shane, you have a question of the minister? Shane, are you there?
Hello, Shane. I hope we didn't lose you there. If you have a question, now's the time to ask.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, Shane, looks like we've lost you on the line. We will move on now. Our next call is from Stan from Drayton Valley. Stan, go ahead. Your line is open.
Hello. I've got a question for the minister. Considering the history of the Parks Minister and the Parks Department for not living up to promises made, example is Eagle Point Blue Rapids and also the Castle area, why should we as residents, taxpayers, and recreation users of Bighorn Country believe the promises now, such as $40 million. Random.
Well, thanks for that. Thank you for that, Stan. Thank you for that question. I can't speak specifically to the Eagle Point Blue Rapids question because that was before my time. Having said that, a public land use zone is not a park. So the piece that is closest to Drayton is not being proposed as a park in any way, shape, or form, because obviously there's so much industrial activity happening there that that obviously putting people to work has to remain the first priority. Now, I can't speak to Castle, and I provided a little bit of context with that in terms of what went into the decision making. All I can say is that Bighorn is different, and every parks decision that we make is different. For example, I've got a decision right out there for public consultation right now in a proposal that Tech, who is an oil sands company, came to us with. And that's a proposal that they came to us with the Mikisew Cree. That is a completely different process than the Bighorn process, which was, again, completely distinct from Castle. It's time for government to step up and be a partner in the Bighorn Country. We understand that people are enjoying it, and I want people to continue to do that. I have wonderful memories of going there myself as a kid. We went to the Brazeau Dam when I was a kid quite a bit. I grew up west of Edmonton. We went out to Rocky. We went to Crimson. We went further west into Nordegg quite a bit. But since that time that I was a kid, in the 1980s, in fact, only in the last decade, 1 million people have moved here. And they all want to get outside too. And we all have a right to go and enjoy ourselves. We just need to make sure that people have the right supports to be able to do so. This is not, Alberta has changed a lot. We're the youngest, best educated, one of the most diverse provinces in the country. People have moved here with their young families, and they want to make those memories just like my parents made them for me in the 80s.
Thanks for your question, Stan. Minister Phillips is taking your questions tonight on the Bighorn Country proposal. Again, if you have a question of the minister, just press star 3. Our next question is from Neil in Sundre. Neil, your line is open.
Yes, good evening, Minister Phillips. I live west of Sundre, and I'm just off the Red Deer River. Now, I think this is a great move to promote tourism in all the smaller communities because things are sort of falling apart out here with the oil industry and the carbon tax introduction and that, and small businesses, they can't seem to keep up out here. So I believe that the introduction of tourism is a great idea. Now, my key question for you is, what's your plans for the preservation of the Red Deer watershed? One of my biggest concerns is that I did a lot of fishing out west, and a lot of the creeks are all gone. The habitat is destroyed from clear cutting. Now, I'm not against logging, but this has been ongoing for many times now. If you haven't been out there lately, I suggest you do a flyby via helicopter over a lot of these areas that have been totally obliterated over the past 50 years or whatever. There's hardly any mechanism in place to protect all of this stuff. Now, my key question is, preferably, what is your intention towards the Red Deer watershed? Because our river out here is depleting every year because the river system is based on the watershed, i.e. Tree cover growth, streams and creeks and stuff like that. I guess I'm done with this question. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Neil. Well, there's a couple of things here, in fact, quite a bit. First of all, in the short term, we're working with the Red Deer Watershed Alliance, we continue to do that. One of the first things I did when I became minister was stabilize funding for watershed organizations because I really believe strongly in the work that they do. Certainly have a number of fish recovery plans in place. Earlier this year, I made sure that we weren't closing streams. Rather, we were looking at management tools, and some of them were in the areas under consideration because we do have fish population issues in some areas, not to the extent that we had in southwest Alberta. You're right that creeks are changing, they're drying up and so on. Part of this has to do with the reality of climate change, that this is happening everywhere. We do have to ensure that part of conservation is recognizing that climate change is real, and we undertake conservation in part to ensure that we're holding water on the landscape, that it's not all just rushing off the eastern slopes and into our cities and into our basements, and that we are using the earth as its natural sponge in areas where it can. As for forestry management practices, they are continually updated and consistent with Eastern Slopes policy and other policies, and we are continually working with the companies to make sure that we are harvesting responsibly, that we are doing so with an eye to intact habitat and watershed health and all of those things. And certainly forestry management practices have changed a lot, and various operators in that area have changed their plans over the years to be more respectful of those values that all of us Albertans care very deeply about. They have tons of ground rules, forestry does, to ensure that that we're being good stewards of the land and good stewards of the water. As for fishery recovery, I think that every area is going to be different. But again, we're going to have to work with whoever the industrial operators are in the particular areas that are still there. And we're going to have to make sure that we have good recreational planning so that, like I said to, I think it was Sherry from Millet, there are some spots where random camping is probably not a great idea if it's causing a bunch of erosion or sedimentation. But we also know that with a little bit of setback from certain water bodies where we know we have issues, where we've got a bit of planning and a bit of enforcement there on the landscape, that we can properly support people getting outside where and how they want. So this is about balancing. This is about enforcement. This is about ensuring we've got good planning, we've got good resources, and we've got some science-based decisions happening out on the landscape.
Tonight we're talking Bighorn Country with Minister Shannon Phillips. Our next caller is also from Sundre. It's Dennis. Dennis, your line is open.
Yes, thank you very much for the opportunity to ask a question. My question is in regards to the grazing allotments and the use of the public lands for grazing, because I was a representative on Alberta Beef for a number of years, and in our area here we have lots of public land that are used for grazing and are managed quite nicely by the people that are grazing in conjunction with our government representatives, and I just would like clarification to see if or to know if there is going to be a total ban of cattle in those areas. And one other thing for that is that I have a large allotment out there with probably several hundred wild horses. Now, I really like the wild horses, and we have so much grass in that area that they don't hurt a thing, a real, you know, anything, and they give people something to look at, and I enjoy them. But it's going to be changed, would the government be trying to remove those wild horses, which I'm not in favor of at all? So that's my questions, and thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Dennis. Some really thoughtful questions there, and I always like hearing from people in the local communities. No change whatsoever to grazing allotments. No change whatsoever to the system, to the existing or to future. We have done this in a number of different areas now. Sometimes grazing leaseholders, if their allotments overlap with a park — this is not for a public land use zone, because public land use zone, there's no change, it's a working landscape. But sometimes when grazing allotments overlap with parks, what we end up doing is we execute a memorandum of understanding. We've done this in Bob Creek Wildland, in Castle, and I believe in one other place. But we do that because sometimes the allotment holders like to work with their operations staff as opposed to park staff, just because they've always had their person that's worked with them out of the operations branch. And what I've done so far in anywhere where this has come up is honored that desire on behalf of the farmers or ranchers or allotment holders when they have requested it. So we have a good template to work with there if that's what you want to do. If not, that's also fine, but just be in touch with us in terms of what you and the others want. As for the feral horses issue, we have not undertaken a call or anything like that. We've got a couple of studies out on the landscape right now in terms of the actual environmental effect of wild horse populations in the various areas, because there's about five different areas where this is an issue. And we'll just continue to work with landowners and make some science-based decisions based on that, kind of a multi-year project. But absolutely no change to grazing. And in fact, as you know, Dennis, and as many cattle ranchers know, The presence of cattle, especially if moved around in a responsible way that we know that that folks are doing out there on the landscape, mimic what used to happen for millennia in terms of bison. And we know that that is a sustainable way to raise our food. We know that people are undertaking that responsibly. And it is absolutely consistent with conservation objectives in provincial parks or in some cases in wildland parks. I know there's at least one in Castle, but mostly it's in the provincial. But we have grazing in Cypress Hills. We have grazing in Dinosaur Provincial Park. Like I said, Bob Creek and Castle. There's got to be a couple of others that I'm not recalling off the top of my head. It is absolutely no problem at all to ensure the peaceful coexistence of those two activities.
Thanks, Dennis, for your question. Let's keep going as we take another question from the phone lines. John from Edmonton, we're ready for your question.
Hello.
Go ahead, John.
Hey, my question was around the PLUZ, and I mean, you say that all designated trails will remain open, but there aren't any. So I'm kind of curious how that process happens. And I mean, the Quad Squad in Calgary had a letter from you saying that all their designated trails remain open and they're all closed. So, I mean, I don't know why this process can't be put on hold until a plan can be made and then released. So that's kind of what I'm questioning.
Yeah, you're right that the public land use zone doesn't have designated trails associated with it. And so the idea would be that, and this the Clearwater Trails Initiative asked us for this, put in place a public land use zone, and then we'll undertake a multi-year process of planning things like good loops, staging areas, bridges, that kind of stuff. Now, we're certainly open to changes around the boundaries of the West Country PLUZ. The other thing that we're open to is a conversation around a trail pass system in order to be able to further invest in these areas. There was a question earlier about where the $40 million is coming from. Well, over 5 years, it's coming from both the capital and operating budgets as part of the overall parks budget, right? And certainly that's something that we continue to invest in anyway. But motorized recreation in terms of bridges and staging areas and so on, it would be good to have a more a stable source of funds for those voluntary groups to be able to draw upon. And that's why I also asked the public what they thought of a trail pass system for this particular area. But as for the, because there are no designated trails right now, you're right, because it's not a public land use zone. But what would happen is the current trails would be open until there were stakeholder plans for any changes that might be made. Of course, the usual caveats apply as they apply right now. If there's a rutting or other things that are getting in the way of pipeline development or other things like that, obviously the folks out on the ground make those determinations to make sure that recreational activity isn't getting in the way of Albertans who are making a living out there on the landscape. As for the final product, I would anticipate that over a period of years, there would be trail maps that were made with the local organizations, with people like you, who engaged thoughtfully in this process, so that we have good, high-quality experiences where people can have those backcountry experiences, where they can get outside, whether motorized or non-motorized. In your case, I take it that you're more interested in motorized, but the issue here is that they would be made with stakeholders, and there would be a very fulsome process of many years in order to be able to do that. This is an issue if people are asking me, well, why would we do the public land use zone first? Well, you get the legal designation, and then you move forward with the other stuff. It's sort of a first pants, then shoes kind of a sequencing. But here's the thing. We can look at the are the boundaries of the public land use zone. And, you know, if local people and municipalities and others, user groups decide that they don't want that kind of exercise, that they don't want trails that are connected to camping areas and staging areas and so on, then we won't do it.
Thanks for your question, John. Minister Phillips is taking your questions tonight on the Bighorn proposal. Our next call is from Sundre. Joanne. Joanne, your line is open.
Okay, thank you. Minister, my question is about the logging and the oil business in the West Country. Like over 55 years ago, my husband worked on rigs out there, and it hasn't changed much since then. Like they're still producing the oil, but they've sure cleaned it all up and everything. But I also am worried about the logging because there isn't anybody around the Sundre area that doesn't have family or good friends working in the sawmill or in the trucking business that goes to the sawmill. And the same with the oil business. I have friends that have trucking companies and different things, and they're hurting. They've cut their rates. They're trying to keep their people employed, but we really need the industry, and it's a real concern.
I hear you, Joanne. You know, I was just thinking when you said folks you know 50 years ago were out there working west of Rocky Mountain House. My dad used to go out and fix oil rigs, and I have many, many memories of him being out in Rocky Mountain House, Nordegg, that whole area when I was a kid. That is still happening. You are right, as is forestry. Now, within all of these proposals, the existing forestry tenure, whether it's a quota or forestry management agreement, are not affected. Oil and gas, existing oil and gas in the parks portion remains and is not affected. Now, within the public land use zone, nothing is affected, not current, not future. What we are seeing in the area that is the wildland portion and in the provincial parks portion is that there is some existing activity, but there's not a lot of activity going on into the future. And none of that existing activity is affected by this, and certainly not in the public land use zone. That is a working landscape. So we carefully designed all of these boundaries to ensure that no forestry and no oil and gas in the wildland or the provincial parks was affected, and that the public land use zone boundaries, both in the Kiska-Wilson and in the proposed West Country public land use zone, that industry was engaged from the very beginning, so that they understood what a public land use zone was and all the rest of it. So the answer to your question, Joanne, is no. Thousands of jobs are not at risk. In fact, quite the opposite. What this ensures is that we've got a bit of diversification happening in the anchor communities, right? So that if people want to start tourism or other outfitting businesses in Rocky or Sundre, that they can do so, that they've got a beautiful landscape that is has a little bit of investment to it, has a little bit more development to it in terms of just things like trails and campgrounds. That existing jobs are not only protected, but are growing into the future as technology and other things help to put our oil and gas industry on better footing. And when we drive through Rocky and other places, we see all those hotels full of pickup trucks.
Thanks, Joanne, for talking the proposal for the Bighorn Country this evening. Our next caller is from Drayton Valley. Lana, your line is open. Go ahead.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear. Go ahead.
Okay. So actually, I'm just listening to the last caller, and this has to do with my question, because it states on your Alberta government website, the Talk AAP, under the Consolidated Site Proposals link, that existing oil and gas, existing logging will continue, but no new exploration, no new logging, no new gravel. So what are you going to do to those people that want to grow their business or expand or bring in new revenue? Like, what are you going to, how are you going to appease them?
Okay.
I'm going to have Rick Blackfoot, who's Assistant Deputy Minister, answer that just quickly here.
Okay, thanks very much for your question. I think the one thing that's important to understand, as Minister's already mentioned, within the parks and protected areas that are being proposed in the Bighorn, there was already no commercial forestry activity. There was some activity from an oil and gas perspective, and as she indicated, that would be grandfathered and still allowed, but no new development from an oil and gas perspective would be allowed that included surface disturbance. Again, outside of the park, there will be a very strong support for ongoing industry and development, no change at all. And in addition, park staff will be working very closely with forestry staff in the parks and protected areas to make sure that they're effectively managing future threats or existing threats, such as mountain pine beetle and fire. So there will be no change to the industrial footprint that we're aware of.
Just to add to that, in terms of the no surface access, a lot of these, most of these areas under consideration, there hasn't been any new lease activity on oil and gas for a long time. A very long time. It's a very mature basin, put it that way. The existing and new oil and gas activity that we're finding via hydraulic fracturing and directional drilling and other things is much further east from those very mountainous areas. As you know, that furthest west portion is its boundaries are Jasper and Banff National Parks. It's quite far away from even oil and gas activity that was going on many, many years ago. So there has been some, and it is mostly wrapped up. We did not receive any industry concerns that I am aware of with those, and we canvassed quite a few, in fact, all of them, on this issue of no new subsurface leases with surface access. That was certainly not something that the industry had any concerns about whatsoever. And certainly the forestry companies, the same applies. They don't have commercial operations. I'm being told to wrap up, everybody, so I'm going to turn everything back over to John from Alberta Environment and Parks. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks, Minister. It's now 7:30, and that's the end of our call tonight. I want to thank all of you once again for taking time out of your busy lives to participate in tonight's telephone town hall meeting. If you weren't able to get through the question with your question, please stay on the line, and I'll be back in a couple minutes with information on how you can still provide your input. I want to assure all of you if you'd like to provide further input into the proposed Bighorn Country Initiative, there are a few ways you can do so. If you remain on the line after this call, you can leave a voice message with your feedback. You can also visit talkaep.alberta.ca and complete the online survey. Please note that the last day to complete the survey is February 15th. Finally, you can also submit written input into aep.bighorncountry@gov.ab.ca. Your input will be used to inform the final plan for Bighorn Country. Thanks once again for joining us this evening, and have a great night.